Okay, the next item of business is portfolio questions, and the portfolio this afternoon is net zero and just transition. I'd remind members wishing to ask a supplementary question to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question, and again remind members of the time allocations for questions and indeed responses. And I call question number one, Willie Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update and progress towards the decarbonisation of buildings and the schemes of assistance that are available to the public to help them make the transition.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
We will publish our annual update on progress against our heat and building strategy by the end of October, and this will include a summary of progress on our support schemes. The Scottish Government offers a range of support to households, including our Warmer Home Scotland and area-based schemes, as well as the Home Energy Scotland grant and loan scheme, which is open to all domestic households in Scotland and provides the most generous grants in the UK for zero direct emissions heating systems.
Willie Coffey.
Thank the Minister for that update. It confirms that Scottish households have access to the most generous grant support in the UK when it comes to increasing the energy efficiency of their homes. Will the Minister note that public awareness and participation is absolutely crucial if this record support is to be granted effectively amid rising costs? And does the Minister agree that Scottish Government interventions are undermined by a UK Government that has failed to tackle sky-high energy prices or support fuel-poor households in Scotland?
Minister.
Willie Coffey is absolutely right on the issue of public awareness, and the public engagement strategy for Scotland will be led by the new Heat and Energy Efficiency Scotland Agency. It's also vital that the UK Government publishes firm plans to rebalance fuel prices, and this is necessary to ensure that climate-friendly heating systems are cheaper to run than fossil fuel systems. So we are pressing the UK Government for more urgent action to enable delivery in Scotland, to address market disincentives for switching to zero emissions heat, and to accelerate decision-making on the potential role of hydrogen. We have clear ambitions to decarbonise buildings faster, and we offer significantly more support for heat pumps and other zero-emission heating systems than other parts of the UK. But we cannot afford to delay taking action, and the UK Government needs to match this ambition.
A number of supplementaries. The number I get in will depend on the brevity of questions and responses. First, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you very much. The Public Audit Committee heard this morning that we have no idea what it will cost to decarbonise buildings in Scotland. Does the Minister accept that he and his government need to set out what this is going to cost individual householders?
Minister.
Well, we do have a high-level estimate of the total cost of decarbonising heating in Scotland. It's very clear that that cannot be met from public funds alone, and we want to make sure that this is affordable for householders, for communities and for businesses, and that will include a blend of public support as well as financial products and role for private investment and the energy industry as well. As we move forward to consult on the heat and building strategy later this year, more detail will be set out.
Sarah Boyd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister say what lessons have been learned from the £133 million underspend on retrofitting homes to make them energy efficient and affordable to heat last year? Because my understanding is that a lack of trained staff was a key blockage across the country. So given that fuel poverty is now hitting 39% of our households, what is the Scottish Government doing to address this massive problem, as well as creating jobs and training opportunities right across Scotland?
Minister.
Well, a range of factors did influence the uptake of voluntary demand-led schemes, both during COVID and in the wake of the cost of living crisis and the spike in energy prices. We need to take account of all of those factors, including, yes, indeed, skills and capacity across the supply chain. Our supply chain delivery programme is working with industry to address those issues. And indeed, this is another of the issues that will be addressed in the consultation that we take forward later this year.
And very briefly, Alistair Allen.
The overwhelming majority of my constituents live in properties not connected to the gas grid, and many are potentially unsuitable for heat pumps. Can the Minister give an indication of what options will be available to those currently reliant on oil in this situation, and what financial support will be on offer?
Minister.
Our approach to reducing emissions from buildings is technology neutral. However, we know that heat pumps are a proven technology that work efficiently when designed and installed correctly, alongside the appropriate energy efficiency measures. Many rural households have already made this transition, and colder countries like Norway and Finland, with very large rural populations, are also far ahead of us. But we recognise that for a small number of buildings, bioenergy might be the best option. We already provide an extra £1,500 on top of the £7,500 Home Energy Scotland heating and energy efficiency grants due to the higher costs in rural areas, and also recently announced an uplift for rural and remote areas in relation to the Social Housing Net Zero Heat Fund.
Question 2, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the second strategic transport projects review in relation to improving the A75.
Mr. Fiona Hislop.
The second strategic transport projects review will inform the Scottish Government's transport investment programme over the next 20 years. As detailed on page 41 of the review, there are clear recommendations for the A75. In August, I met with the leader of Dumfries and Galloway Council and the chair of the Regional Transport Partnership, Swestrans, in Dumfries, where we discussed our shared ambition for the route and the next steps for the bypassing of the villages of Springholme and Crocketford. As we committed to in our programme for government published this week, we will continue to press the UK Government to fulfil their commitment to fund and support the next steps for improvements on the A75, and are awaiting a response to the invited bid issued to them in April. In fact, I'm meeting with the UK Minister responsible, Richard Holden MP, next week to discuss this very issue.
Finlay Carson.
I thank the Minister for that response. In a television interview in Representing Border earlier this week, the First Minister gave a categorical assurance that the A75 and the A77 will get vital improvements. We've, of course, had promises like this before. Indeed, in January of this year, Michael Matheson said the SDPR2 timetable would be published in spring. But with 38 out of the 45 recommendations either started or completed, we're yet to hear of when the A75 improvements will be rolled out. Now, I've previously welcomed the UK Government's constructive collaboration with the Scottish Government on the Euroroute, but given transport is devolved, the failure to deliver on previous commitments lies squarely at the door of this SNP Government. So can the Minister give my constituents an indicative start date for the Springholme and Crocketford bypasses that they've promised but failed to deliver?
Minister.
So, as I answered in my first question, I have been active as a new Transport Minister in engaging with the key stakeholders in Dumfries and Galloway Council and Swestrans, and also with the UK Government, on the basis that the committed support from them has to be resolved in order to commence some of the issues that we are talking about. If we are to do that, as I think has been called for by Mr. Carson, collectively with the UK Government in relation to the connections to Northern Ireland in particular. And it is in that spirit that I will continue my work on this issue.
A couple of brief supplementaries again. Brevity would be appreciated. First, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When the UK Government brought forward the Peter Henry Review, they committed to providing funding to the Scottish Government to improve the safety and efficiency on the A75. And I agree we need these upgrades urgently. But can the Minister indicate whether the UK Government have provided any information on how much funding will be provided and on when it will be received?
Minister.
As called for by a number of people, not least Conservative MSPs, we are cooperating with the UK Government on that. I will be meeting with the Minister responsible, Richard Holden MP, on Monday, and I hope we can agree a way forward and indeed secure the amount of funding that they are seeking to provide.
Thank you. And Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. This transport review was published in December, years late. We were told there would be a delivery plan by spring. Communities in Crocketford and Springholme don't want to hear two governments bickering over who's going to pay for these. They want to see the bypasses take place. So could the Minister give an indication as to when she will tell Parliament exactly when work will be commencing on these communities' bypass? They've been waiting years for an announcement from the government.
Minister.
So I think if you listen to my tone, I was far from bickering and I look to work in cooperation also with the leader of Dumfries and Galloway Council and of the Swestrans chair and with the relevant MP. If people want us to do this in a collective way, I will take that forward. But I do think in terms of that relationship, we need to identify the steps that are required, and as I said, they are actively being discussed as to how that can be delivered. And I will continue to do that in that spirit, as I have committed to.
Mr. Carson. You had an opportunity to ask a question. Would you stop shouting across the chamber, Minister, as briefly as possible?
If we want cooperation to deliver transport projects, perhaps the questions and the answers should reflect that. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Question 3 has not been lodged. Question 4, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to support the development of the necessary harbour infrastructure, including in relation to the operations and maintenance support phase of offshore wind, to deliver a just transition to rural communities such as Fraserburgh.
Scotland's ports and harbours have various ownership models. Fraserburgh is a trust port run by the Fraserburgh Harbour Commissioners. The Scottish Government recognises the importance that ports and harbours infrastructure play in delivering a just transition to coastal communities. The Moray East operations and maintenance base in Fraserburgh has created around 100 local high-value skilled jobs, which will bring economic opportunities as we work towards achieving our net zero ambitions. The strategic investment model will further assist in identifying shared priorities with an initial focus on investment in ports and harbours, infrastructure improvements, manufacturing and fabrication.
Karen Adam.
I'm grateful for that answer. My constituency of Banffshire and Buchan Coast has a huge part to play in Scotland's net zero ambitions, and I thank the Scottish Government for their unrelenting support for the Acorn project at St Fergus, the Moray offshore wind projects, and their funding of the Campaign for North East Rail feasibility study to bring rail back to Peterhead and Fraserburgh. The Fraserburgh Harbour Master Plan has a huge part to play in our net zero goals. Will the Minister please meet with myself and the Harbour Board to discuss their ambitious plans?
Minister.
The Scottish Government recognises the crucial role that the North East plays in working towards achieving those net zero ambitions. And of course, we have been urging the UK Government to commit to carbon capture and storage in Scotland for well over a decade, and the recent long overdue decision to begin that due diligence and discussions with Acorn and recognising the importance of that potential of the Acorn project and the Scottish cluster. The campaign, as referred to, for the North East Rail Group, they are passionate about the railways, and the award of up to £250,000 from the last Just Transition Fund to conduct the multimodal study into transport options is also a step forward. Transport Scotland officials continue to work with those relevant and intended the Fraserburgh Harbour Board on the 20th September to discuss the ambitious plans of the harbour, and I'd be happy to meet with the member to discuss any outcomes from that meeting if that would be of interest.
And brief supplementary, Douglas Lumsden.
Presiding Officer, to unlock the benefits of harbour improvements at Fraserburgh, it's vital that road infrastructure to Fraserburgh is also improved. Last week, 6 people were taken to hospital after a car accident at the Cortes Junction, and we've all heard the many incidents at the notorious Toll of Burness. So can I ask the Minister how many more lives will have to be impacted before this Government will sort out the dangerous road to Fraserburgh? Because without that, a just transition will never be delivered.
Minister.
I reflect on my remarks about the £250,000 for that multimodal study. Clearly, access to harbours and in terms of infrastructure affects residents quite clearly, as I think has been referred to. But with the growing issue and support of the offshore industry, we should also be looking at different issues around freight, etc. I certainly will ask my officials to look at the particular issue that he's raised in terms of those accidents, and I will reply if there's anything additional I can provide to the member to give him some reassurance.
Question number 5, Mercedes Villalba.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress has been made on the development of an offshore training passport as funded by the Just Transition Fund.
Mr Richard Lockhead.
The Scottish Government strongly supports delivery of a skills passport that will work for the different offshore energy industry sectors, recognising the cross-sector skills of workers and the importance of supporting a fair and managed transition. And since the development of our prototype skills passport in 2022, work is ongoing to test and finalise the technical aspects of the passport. Alongside technical developments, project partners across renewables, oil and gas and trade unions have also been working hard to increase cross-sector collaboration on the development of the passport, including seeking agreement on mutual recognition of training requirements across the sectors.
Mercedes Villalba.
The passport is due to be rolled out later this month, but offshore trade unions, like the RMT in particular, remain concerned that their members will end up continuing to pay the price if their qualifications are not recognised by developers and contractors in the offshore wind sector. So will the Minister guarantee that all developers of wind farms leased through ScotWind will be required to recognise the passport, and will he commit to working with the trade unions on implementing the passport when it is finally launched?
Minister.
Well, of course, I'll commit to working with the trade unions to implement the passport once it's finalised. And, of course, we're talking about a major exercise here that will benefit the sector for many, many, many years to come. And the passport involves the close collaboration between the energy industry, its workforce, governments and their agencies, trade unions, trade bodies, skills bodies and education training providers. So it's important we get this right. It's important the industry gets behind it and all parts of the industry going forward. But as I say, as we look towards the energy transition over the next 10 or 20 years, it's important we get this right and we get it in place in a proper way.
Question 6, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its target for renewable heating systems in homes.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Over 1 million homes must convert to zero emissions heating by 2030 if we're to meet Parliament's interim climate targets. We have developed regulations to deliver this in all new buildings. We've also introduced a new Home Energy Scotland grant. We'll shortly relaunch Warmer Homes Scotland, and as I mentioned in response to the earlier question, we'll be consulting soon on proposals for a Heat in Buildings Bill.
Martin Whitfield.
Very grateful. Over the recess, I had pleasure in visiting SunAmp in Trinenty, Slothian, which has become a fantastic growing company that makes heat storage systems for individual domestic use and local housing associations. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, because I know he's aware of the company, what lessons the Scottish Government can learn from this fantastic East Lothian-based company on the importance of heat storage in tackling poverty and net zero commitments?
Minister.
Yes, I and I think a number of other ministers have visited this particular company, been impressed by its work, and I'm pleased to hear that there's cross-party support for that and recognition of the important role that both heat storage as well as electrical storage will play in the future of a decarbonised and renewable energy grid. It's going to have an important role to play as well. Martin Whitfield is quite right in the jobs benefit that will come from the decarbonisation of heat. We believe there are many thousands of jobs, in fact high quality careers to be had in this programme of work, and that will benefit communities the length and breadth of the country.
Again, a bit of interest. I'll try to get all the supplementaries in, but they will need to be brief. First, Ivan McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. District heating systems can offer a number of advantages in decarbonising heating in existing as well as new properties, potentially providing a low-cost, effective solution that enables access to heat sources not available to individual households. What work is the Scottish Government taking forward to accelerate the rollout of district heating networks in existing properties?
Minister.
Thank you. Another hugely important aspect of this agenda. Parliament passed the Heat Networks Act in the last session, and we're implementing that legislation. Public bodies are under a new duty to assess whether their estate would be suitable to connect to district heating systems. And local authorities have powers to identify areas suited to district heating. We're exploring the potential for further legislation to strongly encourage buildings to connect to heat networks. And meanwhile, district heating projects in Scotland can receive pre-development support from our Heat Network Support Unit and grant and loan funding from Scotland's £300 million Heat Network Fund or our District Heating Loan Fund.
Edward Main.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I draw members' attention to my register of interest in that I am a private landlord as well as owning my own house. Renewable heating targets are very important when the government are considering them. Will they publish the estimated cost to the public purse for upgrading the renewable heating in the public, public housing stock?
Minister.
I'm not entirely sure what the member refers to by the public housing stock, whether he's talking about council housing, social housing. We have a very substantial social housing net zero heat fund. The member's aware of that. We work with local authorities as well as housing associations and other social housing providers. And in fact, this is a part of the wider Heat and Buildings programme, and the overall high-level costs that I referred to earlier have been published and put into the public domain.
And very briefly, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Minister was well aware of the Queen's Quay District Heat Network in Clydebank, the biggest in the UK, pioneered by Glasgow-based engineering company Star Refrigeration. They're saying that scaling that across the Clyde corridor with the potential to take hundreds of thousands of homes and businesses off the gas grid is constrained by access to affordable electricity. What is the Minister doing to unlock that opportunity for affordable electricity supply along the Clyde and also to get that density of commitments or the planning obligations together that would unlock huge potential
investment? As briefly as possible, Minister.
We engage actively both with STAR, who's showing the jobs potential for manufacturing in relation to decarbonisation of heat, as well as the Queen's Quay development. I hope all members will encourage local authorities and public bodies and housing associations to access the support for heat networks that I referred to earlier. But the issues around affordability of electricity supply, come back to that, regulatory power that currently sits with the UK level. If we're going to decouple gas and electricity prices, we need the UK government to act, and that would enable us to pass on the benefit of the cheap, abundant, clean, green, renewable electricity that's being generated in this country to benefit bill payers.
Question 7, Bob Dorey.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its action to achieve net zero will be supported by the recently agreed partnership between Skills Development Scotland and Built Environment Smarter Transformation.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the construction sector is critical to achieving a just transition to net zero, and the Scottish Government is supporting a range of plans for a more sustainable, innovative and diverse construction industry. This new strategic partnership, which Mr Dorris refers to, will allow Built Environment Smarter Transformation and Skills Development Scotland to collaborate to identify ways which the construction industry can help the sector address its net zero challenges.
Bob Dorris.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. As we navigate the economic changes that will be accompanying transitioning to a net zero society, apprentices with the skills and knowledge to transform sectors such as construction, as has been mentioned, will be crucial to Scotland's drive towards net zero. What role does the Cabinet Secretary see apprentices playing in this journey?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, apprenticeships are a really critical tool for employers to invest in their workforce and to provide the skills needed to support that imperative of transitioning to net zero. They are vital for supporting young people into valuable, rewarding careers and helping people to upskill, reskill and progress in their chosen careers. In fact, statistics published by SDS show that in 22-23, construction operations had the largest number of overall starts at 26%, and we'll continue to work collaboratively to maintain and to boost that number.
Thank you. Question 8, Sandy Scolhani.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it has conducted any analysis of how many deaths on the A9 could have been prevented if it had been fully duelled.
Minister.
One death on our roads is one too many, and the tragic fatal accidents recorded on the A9 in 2022 and 2023 have occurred on dual and single sections. There will be families grieving, as there will be for all deaths on our roads. An assessment of potential future reductions in mortalities of duelling the whole length of the A9 has not been made. However, the 2016 case for investment for the A9 duelling programme between Perth and Inverness forecasted approximately 6 fewer fatalities annually following duelling. This comparison is with performance prior to average speed camera introduction, following which there's been an average reduction of 3 deaths annually compared to baseline. This assessment will be updated as part of the work considering the optimal approach for completion of the A9 duelling programme.
Sandy Scolhani.
The Minister's right, deaths on dual and single roads, but let me tell the Minister that deaths on single carriageway sections of the A9 have outnumbered deaths on dualled carriageway sections by 20-1 over the past 5 years. 20-1. Dual carriageways in such an important route are much safer. Will the Cabinet Secretary be specific in Parliament and provide a timetable for the full duelling of the A9? And if unable to respond now with that, will the Secretary commit to providing me with a written response this month?
Minister.
The Minister for responding. On Tuesday, the First Minister announced the contract notice for the duelling of the Tomatin to Moy and that it has been issued, reaffirming this Government's commitment to full duelling of the A9, and I would have thought the Member would have wanted to welcome that. The Scottish Government will provide more detail, including timelines and detail, to full duelling in the autumn, as was planned and announced several times before the summer recess in this chamber to those MSPs who attended the chamber.
Lots of supplementaries. I won't get them all in. I'll get as many as I can. First, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister has reaffirmed his cast-iron commitment to the folk of the Highlands, and the SNP has a record of delivering infrastructure projects for Scotland that the Scottish Government will continue to deliver on. The cost of Doolin to Martin to Moy has risen from £115 million to £150 million. Can the Minister outline what impact inflation caused by the Tory economic negligence and cuts to Scotland's capital budget is having on the Government's ability to deliver on projects like this?
Minister.
So the Member makes an important point. I think the first point to make is we are going to dual the A9. The second... So I'm not sure if members, President Officer, if I take the intervention of the questions from the heckling or whether I do it from the members. So in relation to what the member was asking, there is a significant pressure on the capital budgets of this government, not least because of the economic mismanagement that has taken place over recent times. The inflation aspect has had a considerable impact on construction costs, but the fact that our budget has not had a 7%, hasn't had an uplift for inflation, has meant there's been a 7% cut in our capital budget. Despite that, you have had a commitment in the programme for government from the First Minister that we will dual the A9.
Thank you. We don't have any more time. We need to move on to the next item of business. That concludes portfolio questions on net zero and just transition.